Good morning, students. In today's class, we will learn about one more topic from the chapter The Living Word, and that topic is nomenclature. Nomenclature, in general term, it is referred as naming. Okay? What is nomenclature? Nomenclature is nothing but science of giving names to the organisms. Okay? It is a science of giving names to the organisms. Okay, now we have discovered a new organism on this earth. We will go identify the organism and we will give a name, which we call as scientific name to that particular organism. Okay, so every organism that have been identified till today, they have certain names. Okay, with the help of these names, we can identify any organism. Now, every country use a local name to represent an organism. Okay, generally what happens is we use local names to name any organisms or represent an organism. For example, we use the local name as mango, right? We call mango a mango, right? Now, if we go to any foreign countries and ask them what is mango, they may not know what is a mango. Okay, because mango is generally a local name used by only English speaking people. Okay, and we call a mango, this particular fruit as mango, and only English speaking people call this fruit a mango. However, if you go to a Spanish-speaking country or a French-speaking country, they may not identify this local name mango. Okay, they may not, they may not understand this term mango. Okay, so that is the reason when we give name to any organism. Okay, if you are naming a mango tree, then we cannot be calling it as a mango tree, because mango tree becomes a local name. Okay, that is the reason we have to use a global name. Global name means if you are using that particular name, that particular plant or animal or microbe will be known throughout the world with that specific name. Okay, for example, if we are using the name as Mangifera indica, if we use this name Mangifera indica, Mangifera indica is the scientific name for mango. Okay, Mangifera indica is the scientific name for mango. Whereas mango, we generally, it is a local name. Mangifera indica is a scientific name which will be used globally. Okay, so generally what happens is the local names that we use for any organism may not be identified at global level. You go throughout the world, the local names that you use for one particular organism may not be known by the people belonging to different countries. That is the reason for every organism that we identify or that we discover, we have to give a scientific name. We have to give a scientific name. This process of giving a scientific name to an organism is known as nomenclature. It is a science of giving names to the organisms. When I speak about name, it is nothing but giving a scientific name. We cannot be using the local names. we have to give a scientific name to any organism that we discover. And this process of giving scientific name to that particular organism is known as nomenclature. Okay, and nomenclature is usually done by two authorities. One is known as ICBN. ICBN represents International Code for Botanical Nomenclature, and the second one is ICZN, International Code for Zoological Nomenclature. Okay, usually these biological names, how it has to be given, it is decided by ICBN and ICZN. They are the two organizations. ICBN means International Code for Botanical Nomenclature. Okay, botanical nomenclature, the name itself indicates botany. It represents plant. So, if you are naming a plant, then you have to use or you have to follow the rules and regulations of ICBN, International Code for Botanical Nomenclature. If you are naming an animal, then zoological, zoology represents animal, right? So, if you are naming any particular animal, then you have to follow the rules given by ICZN, International Code for Zoological Nomenclature. Nomenclature is nothing but naming. So, I hope this is clear to you. Any organism that is identified newly on this earth should be given a name. We cannot give a local name to this organism because local names may not be identified globally or throughout the globe. That is the reason we always have to give a scientific name to any organism that we identify so that it can be identified or it can be detected throughout the globe with that particular scientific name. Okay, under this topic we will have to study about there's one more concept known as binomial nomenclature, which is a very important concept under nomenclature. Very important, when I say important, with respect to your examination. So you know what is nomenclature, we'll have to know what is binomial nomenclature. Binomial nomenclature. Now, speaking about mango, I mentioned that the scientific name of mango is Mangifera indica. Let's take few more examples. Let's take human beings. The scientific name of human beings is Homo sapiens. Let's take cat. The scientific name of cat is Felis domestica. Okay? Now clearly observe these three scientific names given for three different organisms. This is a mango, it's a plant, human, animal, cat, again a plant. Let's take a bacteria. The name given to this bacteria is E. coli. Okay? Here, if you see the scientific name, these are scientific names, not the local names. These are the local names, these are the scientific names. If you look at these names, you can make out that every scientific scientific name has two components. This is the first component. This is the second component. First, second. First, second. First, second. Okay, so every scientific name of any organism for that matter has two components. Okay, so since every scientific name is made up of two components, this particular naming is known as binomial nomenclature. Bi means two names. Okay, so naming an organism with two components, okay, that is known as binomial nomenclature. Bi, two, nomial means naming, again you are using two names, nomenclature, the process of naming. You are naming any particular organism with two names or two components is known as binomial nomenclature. Naming an organism with two components. Okay, this is the first component, this is the second component. This process of naming with two components is known as binomial nomenclature. Then, what are these two components? In every name, you see the first component here, Mangifera, Homo, Felis, E. E actually represents Escherichia. Okay? These first names represents genus name. Okay? So, every name of any organism will be having two components. The two components, the first component is always genus. The first name always represents the genus. And the second component, Indica, Sapiens, Domestica and Coli, they represent species name. Which species they belong to? Species. Okay, so every organism, every scientific name will be having two components. This type of naming with two components is known as binomial nomenclature. In the two, out of two components, one represents genus, the other represents species. Okay, this is genus, this is species. Felis is genus, Domestica is species. Escherichia is genus, Coli is species. Okay, so this type of naming is known as binomial nomenclature. Who actually started this binomial nomenclature? A person called as Carolus Linnaeus started this binomial nomenclature. He started using these names in his book called as Systema Naturae. Okay, he wrote a book called Systema Naturae. In this book, he has actually mentioned about the binomial nomenclature. He has used two components or two names to represent one particular organism. Okay, so the person who introduced this binomial nomenclature is Carolus Linnaeus in his book Systema Naturae. Now, generally, we know that every organism must be given a scientific name following the rules of ICBN and ICZN. Now, for binomial nomenclature also, we have actually certain rules. While giving or while writing scientific name of any organism, we have to follow certain rules. Okay, generally, if we have used this word, name Mangifera indica, then we are following certain rules. Okay, what are those rules? We will study it now. They are called as rules of binomial nomenclature as given by ICBN, International Code for Botanical Nomenclature. Okay, now you know that the two components of a binomial nomenclature is genus and species. Generally, it is also referred as generic name. You can write it either way. You can write it as genus or generic name. Species is also represented as specific epithet. Okay, the genus name can also be called as generic name. Species can also be represented as specific epithet. Okay, now let's move on to the rules of binomial nomenclature. Rules of binomial nomenclature as given by ICBN, International Code for Botanical Nomenclature, has given these rules in order to give a scientific name to any organism. Okay, now there are actually 5 rules. Let me begin with the first rule. The first rule I have already discussed. Every scientific name should have 2 components. The first component or the first name represents the genus name. The second name represents the species name. Okay, this is the first rule. It will have, every scientific name will have 2 parts or 2 names. The first one is genus name and the second name is known as species name. Okay, this itself is the first rule of binomial nomenclature. Now, the second rule, it's easy to make out from here that if you look into the genus name clearly, the genus name has started with a capital letter, whereas the species name has started with a small letter. Okay, so in a scientific name, the first letter of the genus, the first letter of the genus will be capital. All the other letters will be small letters. Okay, you will not be using a capital letter to represent the first letter of the species also. Only the first letter of the genus will be capital. Rest all the letters will be small letters. Okay, only the genus name starts with a capital letter. Species name always starts with a small letter. Rest all the letters will be small letters. Okay, the first letter of the genus is capital. If you write this much, it's enough. The first letter of the genus is capital. Rest all the letters are small letters. This is the way you have to write. Here also you can see the first letter I have written in capital. Rest all small. Capital, small. This is capital. This is also small. All the letters. Okay. Now moving on to the next rules of ICBN or rules of binomial nomenclature. I want all of you to know that this is a very, very important question with respect to your examination. Okay, they will ask you the rules of binomial nomenclature or what is binomial nomenclature. You can just write, naming an organism with 2 components, which are genus and species, is known as binomial nomenclature. Then the next rule of binomial nomenclature is that scientific name is always in Latin. Scientific names, these are all known as scientific names, are always in Latin. These are all Latin names. Okay? If you are not using Latin, if you are using an English name, that name also should be Latinized. So ultimately, all the names should be in Latin. English names, if you are using any, should be Latinized. It should be converted into Latin. Okay, so the scientific name is always written in Latin language. Even if you are using English names, it should be Latinized. That is the third rule of binomial nomenclature. Then moving on to the fourth rule of binomial nomenclature. Here you can see every component, both the components of a scientific name have been underlined, right? Both the components, the genus as well as the species, both the names are underlined. Okay, here also underlined. If you are not underlining it, then you have to write these names in italic. You know the font italics. Okay, generally we use it in the in the computer we make the font as italics. Okay, so if you are not underlining these scientific names, then it should be written in italics. You know, right? It goes like this. Okay, if you are writing this way, that is known as generally italics. If you are unable to use italics, then you should always write the what scientific names. I know you should always underline the scientific name. So either the scientific name should be written in italic, or if you are not able to write it in italic font, then it should be underlined. Okay, if you are using MS Word and MS Excel, you might have seen this italic font. Okay, so you have to write it in italic font. If you are writing it in italic font, then you don't have to underline these components. Okay, you do not have to underline these components. However, if you are not writing these scientific names in italics, then you should always underline it. For me, underlining is very convenient rather than writing in italics, so I always underline these scientific names. Okay, you also make this a practice. Okay, so always any scientific name when you are writing it, it should be underlined. The genus name should be written in caps and rest all the letters should be written in small letter. Okay, so this is the fourth rule. Don't get confused between this rule and third rule and the fourth rule. Here I'm saying the word that you are using, it should be a Latin word. Here I'm saying while writing, even though you are using a Latin word, it should be written in italics. If you are not writing in italics, then you should underline these two components or these two names. This is the fourth rule of binomial nomenclature. Let's move on to the next rule of binomial nomenclature, which is that the discoverer's name should be written at the end of scientific name. So this is a scientific name, Mangifera indica. Who discovered this Mangifera indica for the first time? If Carolus Linnaeus, then I am writing Carolus Linnaeus' name in an abbreviated form at the end of the scientific name. Mangifera indica Linn. Linn represents Carolus Linnaeus, who first discovered this particular plant. Okay, now should be written at the end of the scientific name in an abbreviated form. You cannot be writing Mangifera indica Carolus Linnaeus, that will be too lengthy. In order to cut it short, you will write the discoverer's name in an abbreviated form. Carolus Linnaeus has been abbreviated as Linn. So it should be written at the end of the scientific name in an abbreviated form. Hope this is clear to you. All the rules of binomial nomenclature. First, rule is that every scientific name has two components. First one is genus, second one is species, generic name or specific epithet. The first letter of the genus is always capitalized, rest all the letters will be small. Then the name should be in Latin. I'm sure by looking at these names, you will be able to identify that no term here is an English word. They are all Latin words. Okay? Now, and when you are writing this, it should be written in italic font. If you are not using it italics, then you should always underline the scientific name. Then, the person who has discovered that particular plant can be, or any organism, his name or his or her name should be written at the end of the scientific name in an abbreviated format. Okay, so these are the rules of binomial nomenclature. Next, we have to move on to another process of, your taxonomy. That's what we call as, I'm sure this word is new to you. We will see what is taxonomy, what is known as classification. Before that, let us study few scientific names we should be studying. However, when you go to that topic known as classification, I will explain all the scientific names of few organisms to you. The next topic is classification. Classification means, let's take human beings. Our scientific name is Homo sapiens. Our scientific name is Homo sapiens. Homo is the genus, sapiens is the species. Okay, now Homo sapiens are classified into different categories. We human beings are categorized into different, are grouped into different categories. Which are those categories? This is our species. Human species is represented as Homo sapiens. Okay. Now, this is not sufficient in order to this name known as Homo sapiens will just explain that we all belong to the species known as Homo sapiens and we all are one type of organisms. Now, how are we related to other organisms present on this world? In order to know that, every organism have to be grouped into different categories. Okay, so that process of grouping an organism into different categories based on observable characters. Now, we human beings call ourselves Homo sapiens. We all are Homo sapiens. Why do we call ourselves as Homo sapiens? How we were able to give the scientific name to ourselves? Because we all look alike. based on the observable characters. Right? When I look at another human being, another person, I can make out he is just like me. So he is also Homo sapien. Okay, similar way we are able to identify all the human beings as Homo sapiens, and we all belong to one particular species. Okay, now based on observable characters, I have done the grouping of an organism as Homo sapiens. But this is not sufficient. I need to categorize them. Okay, this I have given one category as species to Homo sapiens, but I need to give few more categories to these Homo sapiens. I need to go to higher level of classification, which actually shows how I am related to a dog, how I am related to a cat, how I am related to a plant. Okay, so these comparison can be made only when you classify the organism. Okay, so such categorization process is known as classification. If I give you any new organism, if I have identified any one new organism, I need to classify those organisms into different categories. Then I will finally come to a conclusion that this is so and such and so and so organism. Okay, how do we do it? For that, this process of classification is known as taxonomy. Okay, in the process where you classify the organism is known as, the process of classification is known as taxonomy. Okay, the process of classification is known as taxonomy. Now, for Homo sapiens, let me talk about something called as taxon first, so that I will be able to explain it clearly. Taxon means the rank or the category that I give to a particular organism. The rank or the category that is being given to any organism is known as taxon. For example, I have given the name as Homo sapiens. This is a taxon given to, this is one taxon given to human beings. Okay, what are the other taxon? Actually, there are 7 taxons. Which are they? Phylum is the first taxon. Class, or generally it is also represented as division, is the second taxon. Order, this is the third taxon. Family, fourth taxon. Genus, fifth taxon. Species, sixth. Sorry, actually here there's one more. I forgot to write it. Okay, the first taxon is kingdom. Second is phylum. Third is class. Fourth is order. Fifth is family. Sixth is genus. Seventh is species. Okay, now every organism that is present on this particular earth, on our earth, has these 7 taxon or 7 ranks. Okay, these taxons are nothing but ranks or category. We human beings also, we have 7 ranks in the process of classification. Okay, which are those ranks? I will study. Before that, I will teach you. You will be studying it. Before that, you should know there are 7 taxon or 7 ranks or 7 categories that we, every organism is belong to. Okay, which are those 7 taxons? Kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. I will explain with example so that it is better for you to, it will be easy for you to understand. Now you know that what is classification? When you group the organism, into different categories. That process is known as classification. It is also known as taxonomy. The process of classification itself is known as taxonomy. Now I have mentioned there are 7 taxons. Let's study all the 7 taxons with the help of Homo sapiens or human beings. Now let's write the first taxon as kingdom. Okay, which kingdom we all belong to? Which kingdom we Homo sapiens belong to? We belong to the kingdom Animalia. Right? Animalia. We all belong to the kingdom Animalia. So 7 taxons of human beings I'm writing here. So there are 7 taxons or 7 ranks that you can give to every organism. Okay, so the first kingdom or the highest level of rank is kingdom. We all human beings belong to this kingdom Animalia. Then kingdom is the highest rank, so I am writing the upward arrow mark. Phylum. We all belong to, all the human beings belong to the phylum Chordata. All the human beings present on earth, we all belong to this phylum known as Chordata. Then the next class, okay? We all belong to this class known as Mammalia. Why we belong to this particular phylum known as Chordata? Because all the human beings, we have chordates or the backbone. That is the reason we come under this phylum Chordata. Let me explain this also. Okay, why we come under kingdom Animalia? Because we are all animals. And every animal present on our earth comes under this kingdom Animalia. Since we are also animals, we come under this kingdom Animalia. Then why phylum Chordata? Chordata includes only those organisms. This phylum Chordata includes only those organisms which have backbone, or what we call as notochord. Okay, since we have backbone, we have notochord, we come under this particular phylum Chordata. Under Chordata, we come under this class Mammalia. Okay, class Mammalia. Why do we come under class Mammalia? Because we all the human beings are mammals. Right, we deliver offsprings and we, human beings, they breastfeed the offsprings or the babies. Such organisms are known as Mammalia. Since we all are Mammalia, we deliver the young ones. The young baby develops inside a mother's womb and it will be delivered. Since we deliver the young ones, we are known as mammals. So we all belong to this class Mammalia. Then comes the next level or the rank, order. We belong to the order Primata. We all are primates. Like, we have separate fingers, we have separate toes, unlike other organisms where they will be having webbed finger, webbed toes. Okay, so there are separate different characteristics of primata which we actually fulfill. Okay, so that is the reason human beings come under this order Primata. Then comes the family. We all belong to this family known as Hominidae. All the human beings present on the earth, we all match each other in our own characteristics, like we have two hands, two legs, our brain capacity is almost the same, how we appear is same. Okay, so we all belong to this family known as hominidae. Then comes the genus. We all know the genus name is Homo. Then comes the species. The species name is sapiens. Right? So this is the level of classification. Now, a simple human being like me and you, we have been categorized under 7 ranks: kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. Okay, so these are the 7 ranks we all have or we all belong to. Okay, so our ranks is kingdom Animalia, phylum Chordata, class Mammalia, order Primata, family Hominidae, genus Homo, species Sapiens. Okay, so we have 7 categories. We belong to 7 categories. This process of grouping one organism into different category is known as classification. I hope this is clear to you. When we group one particular organism into different categories or different rank or different taxon, okay, category, rank, taxon are all different. Okay, so we are belonging to 7 different category or 7 different rank or 7 different taxon. If you ask me which is the highest level of rank, kingdom is the highest level of rank. Then which is the lowest level of rank? Species is the lowest level of rank. Kingdom is the highest level of rank of human, every organism. So human beings belong to 7 different category. This process of grouping the organism into different categories is known as classification. Now there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 taxons. All the 7 taxons together we can call them as taxa. Okay, taxon is a singular word that we use for every single category, whereas taxa is a aggregated term that we use for all the taxons. So you can say taxon is a singular form, taxon is a singular form that we use for every category, taxa is the plural. For all the taxons together, for all the taxons together we use this term taxa. Okay, so every rank is known as taxons. All the taxons together known as taxa. This process of doing or grouping the organism into different taxon is known as taxonomy. This process of classification where we give different rank or different category to one particular organism is known as taxonomy. I hope this is clear to you. After this, we will move on to study about the scientific names and the taxonomy of few other organisms. Now, we know everything about taxonomy. Now, there is one more term known as taxonomical hierarchy. Taxonomical hierarchy. Okay, hierarchy means when you move from a lower level to the higher level or a higher level to lower level. Generally it is referred as hierarchy. Now, we all know that we have studied about classification. Classification is not a single step, right? It's not a single step to procedure. We have to group the organism into various categories. Here, 7 categories. So it is not a single step process. It is a process involving many steps. Now we know that There is a kingdom, there is a phylum, there is a class, order, family, genus, species. Every step, all the step together, it is known as taxonomical hierarchy. Species is leading to genus. Genus will lead to family. It is an ascending order. I have written in an ascending order. Family leads to order. Order leads to class. Class leads to phylum. Phylum leads to kingdom. So it is a hierarchy or a number of steps, right? So this hierarchy is known as taxonomical hierarchy. So if you are writing this way, the taxonomical hierarchy is in ascending order. Kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. It is the taxonomic hierarchy. Okay, various steps. Classification is not a single step process. It is a process involving many steps. If we are categorizing the organism, we have to categorize it into seven different levels. So these seven different levels is totally referred as taxonomical hierarchy. It is an ascending order, moving from species to the kingdom, because species comes first, right? Then the species, many species come together, they form a genus. Many genus come together and form a family. Related family come together and form order. Related orders come together and form a class. Related class come together and form a phylum. And related phylum come together and forms the kingdom. This is known as taxonomical hierarchy. We will study about the scientific names of few organisms. They are important. So you have to study about potato. Solanum. Tuberosum. Brinjal. Solanum, Melangina, Cat, Felis, Domestica. Okay. Now, in your study material, here while explaining the classification, I have briefed you about the classification with reference to Homo sapiens. In your study material that I have provided to you, you have three more classifications. I think you have the classification for wheat, you have for mango, and you have it for housefly. Okay, all these classifications you have to study by yourself. You have to understand which are the different levels or which are the different taxons in the taxonomical hierarchy. Study by yourself. All the other three I have explained one to you here. All the four are very important. Scientific name of potato, brinjal, cat. Here you have to also add a mango. Mangifera indica. Since I have taken examples, too many times, I am not writing it again. This is all about classification and how taxonomy works. Then in the next session, we will have to study about different levels of classification. We will study what is a species, what is a genus, what is a family, order, class, phylum and kingdom. We will study every single taxon one by one in detail. Okay. Thank you for today. There's one more topic called as taxonomical aids, which are very, very important topic. In this particular chapter, the living world, that is also very important to you. The important questions are the taxonomical hierarchy itself, the binomial nomenclature, the rules of binomial nomenclature, about Carolus Linnaeus, because he proposed binomial nomenclature, his book Systema Naturae, And the next topic which I will be dealing with is taxonomical age. That's a very, very important question for your 5 marks. With this, I am concluding today's class. Let's meet in the next class. I hope you understood everything. If you have any confusion, you can always get back to me. Thank you.